so a little bit about me. You already heard, like, I'm self-taught. I studied sociology, not very technical, and that's also one of the reasons why I really like software that has a social impact. It's one of the reasons why I like Python, because it really has an empowering community. It's like an emancipating software project, and I believe so are blockchains. The last about 2 years I spent in a cryptocurrency company. Well, at the beginning a startup, now about 100 people company. I switched from there. I'm in a startup again, since that's a lot nicer, and now we are trying to bring industry data to the blockchain. I really like open source, and I'm not very, very, very good at doing slides. Since this is not my laptop, how do I get to the next slide?
I think with the...
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, is it good?
I feel it. Okay, so very basic, what is a blockchain? I'll start off with a somewhat more formal definition. A blockchain is basically just an incremental data structure in discrete packages, where each package is linked cryptographically to the previous package. That sounds a little bit academic, and there are some very academic blockchain projects out there for those who like that, like Cardano. Though most people like it a little bit less academic, so in a less formal formulation, less formal definition, a blockchain is an append-only database, so you can only write into this database, you can read from this database, though you can never delete from this database. It's chunked into blocks, into discrete blocks, and every block contains a pointer, usually a hash, to the previous block. The hash of the previous block guarantees that the state of the previous block is fingerprinted in a block. The first block can't have a fingerprint to the previous block. It's called the genesis block. It's rather important in blockchains that the genesis block can be distributed in a secure way. For example, in Bitcoin, it happened in 2009 that the genesis block was created and is now available for download from many, many, many sources. What are like some properties of blockchains? We usually think as blockchain as distributed or decentralized systems. It's not a property that they need to have to just fulfill the definition, but it's very useful. It can be run on many, many, many different distributed systems that does not have to be like a central authority that runs the whole blockchain, since the data is always validated in the next block. There needs to be some kind of consensus protocol to form the next block, since everyone in this decentralized network has to agree what the valid continuation is. There are different kinds of consensus protocol to select this next block, which I'll tell you about in a minute or two. First, a short distinction between what are public and what are private blockchains. So some people in the community would say only public blockchains are true blockchains. Those are the ones where everyone has equal access. All the data on those blockchains is publicly available. It may be encrypted, so not everyone can read it, but everyone can download it, store it, and that's even one of the qualities one wants to have, since this also makes it very a very secure storage of information. It can basically not be killed by anyone, since every participant has a copy of the whole thing. It's also a little bit of the drawbacks, because that means every participant needs to have a copy of the whole thing. For Bitcoin, for example, the whole blockchain is by now about order of magnitude 200 gigabytes in size. So that's not something everyone wants to provide, especially if you're just running it on some small Raspberry Pi hardware or something. Private blockchains, on the other hand, are mainly used in business applications. They have some level of permission system where often the consensus protocol, who gets to make the next block, how the next block is formed, is based on some permissions where only some authorities can do that. There is one blockchain where people can vote for who gets to make the next block. There is blockchains where it's defined by the Genesis block with some secure key, and a central authority, for example, is established. And that's why some people don't really like private blockchains. They are still useful, especially in business contexts where data needs to be private sometimes, sometimes for legal reasons too. So on the cryptocurrencies, these are one of the applications that blockchains are used for. Probably everyone has heard about Bitcoin. Ethereum is the second most famous blockchain. It's kind of similar to Bitcoin, but also has so-called smart contracts, which I will talk about a little bit later. Ripple, Monero, all fulfilling different roles and niches. Monero I personally like since it's a truly anonymous coin. On Bitcoin, people think often it's an anonymous network, but it's not really, it's pseudonymous. Everyone can trace what happens. They can trace it to some public key. On Monero, it's actually really untraceable if transactions happen. How do cryptocurrencies work? They're basically a distributed ledger. So there is, and the awesome thing they did is solve the double spend problem of digital money. Every participant who has some funds has a so-called wallet, which is basically a private key. In the ledger, there is associated to the public key that belongs to that private key, some balance. And only the owner of the private key can sign a so-called transaction, which transfers funds, the cryptocurrency, which can be by this transaction assigned to a different key. And one of the beauties is that this can actually be done only once. Even if I have the private key, I can sign hundreds of transactions to spend my money, but only one of those can become part of a legal block. Because there is a consensus protocol that guarantees that only a block can be appended to the blockchain that does not spend money that has already been spent, that does not spend funds that have already been spent. In Bitcoin, this is done by mining. It's also done in Ethereum, in Ripple, in Monero. There's a few coins that have slightly different approaches. Mining is, for example, in Bitcoin, finding a hash that has certain properties. It has to be close to zero. Takes on average about 10 minutes to find this hash with by now immense computing power. Whoever manages to find that hash first gets to make the next block, and every other participant validates that this block is actually legal, that it contains the link to the previous block, that all the transactions in there are legal, and then append it to their blockchain, to their copy of the database. And this mining, since it's so costly, since it requires a lot of hash power, a lot of CPU cycles, is rewarded by the cryptocurrency itself. When you mine a Bitcoin block, you get 12 Bitcoin at the moment. Everyone can do it in theory, though there's like warehouses full of CPUs, full of ASICs in China that's hard to compete with. A few properties. Why? What are they good for? One of the main properties of the blockchain is they are trustless, which is very important in the blockchain space. Which means, even if I don't trust anyone else who participates in this whole thing, I can still trust the outcome of it. Even if I think like everyone else is just selfish and just wants to defraud me, wants to rob me, wants to take all my funds away if they could, I can still trust that that the whole network will generate correctly blocks, will generate blocks that are valid. in case of Bitcoin with the slight limitation, as long as not one single entity controls more than 50% of the hash power. It's a somewhat unsolved problem to make blockchains trustless with no limitations, but so far it has worked pretty well, since it's very, very, very hard to gain control over more than 50% of a network. For other networks, you would have to gain more than 50% of all coins. And even if you manage to do that, once you use that control you have over the network, you would basically kill the network, make it non-trustworthy anymore. And since you have a huge stake, since you own 50% of it, that wouldn't be a very wise decision. So all you need to trust is for people to actually be somewhat selfish and rational, and you can trust the whole network. Besides trustlessness, they are tamper-free. It's extremely hard to modify any data once it has become part of the blockchain. As I said, in Bitcoin, you would have to find a hash that fulfills this property of being somewhat close to zero, which is extremely hard if you wanted to create a competing valid block on top of the last valid block. This can be like pretty useful in the company I work now. Our business model is basically collecting data from big production machines and giving it to banks and insurances who want to be sure that they are not defrauded by the big companies who run the machines. In a blockchain, we can guarantee them that once the data is in there, they will not modify it. It's basically mathematically impossible for anyone to modify the data once it is in the blockchain database. So, blockchains are tamper-free. Decentral, that's one of the properties most cryptocurrency advocates really, really like. Cryptocurrencies, especially Bitcoin, the first one, were based on the idea of having a currency which is not controlled by a central bank. Bitcoin is not. It's not controlled by any singular entity. It's, like I said, decentral. Nobody can just change the amount of Bitcoin. There's a fixed amount of 21 million. It will always be there. That number can never change. You can absolutely trust this, trust that no actor can mess with your money if your money is Bitcoin. Then some coins, like I said, for example, Monero, provide anonymity, true anonymity, where it's mathematically impossible to trace your transactions. Can be good, can be bad. Other provide the opposite, traceability, which is also something my current company works on. Once you put data on the blockchain, it can be traced there forever, because it's also tamper-free. You can put an RFID chip on some piece that came out of a production machine. Every time it's scanned, we put a timestamp on the blockchain. We can this way perfectly trace, without any chance for anyone to intervene to fake some data in there on the blockchain, the way this product takes from the machine where it's produced to the end consumer. And then there's, like I mentioned, the so-called smart contracts. That's when blockchains become a bit more intelligent, where transactions cannot just associate funds with a new private key, but they can also execute code and can contain some logic. Usually blockchains have some reference implementation, a node which contains some definition of some scripting language or some more complex language, and a transaction that includes some code is run by every participant on their node. Whatever the result of that is put into the blockchain. If everyone agrees, that becomes part of the blockchain now and can never be modified. It's also been called code as law. Since I guess everyone here is a programmer, I hope code does not become law. I have had bugs in my code before. I have lost actual money with smart contracts, not much, like a few euros or so, but playing around with those. It can hurt if nothing can be changed anymore, but they can also be, like I said, very, very useful. They are self-executing contracts. There does not need to be any party once you have the contract established on the blockchain. You feed the data in, everyone knows the code, that is, which is also public, which is also part of the blockchain usually, and will know and can determine what the result will be. This also introduced to some blockchains the concept of a so-called chain state, where transactions modify some state. For example, you could think in a cryptocurrency how much balance of the currency each user has at the moment as the state of the blockchain. Some blockchains are way more complex, where you can have arbitrary data, arbitrary objects in the chain state, which can be modified by the smart contracts. So much for blockchains in general. Why Python? And yeah, I have to make it a little bit quick. So in Python, we can do some things. One thing is develop or participate in actual blockchain development with Python. One main thing is Ethereum. The second biggest blockchain has a Python implementation called PyEthereum. So if you want to really get down to the implementation details to how to like create an actual blockchain, that's a project where some people can work with. For Bitcoin, there does not exist yet a full implementation of Bitcoin in Python, but there is a Fin client, which is a node, a server that does not validate every block. It just looks at the chain of the hashes, more or less, and throws away all the old data since it doesn't care about that anymore. It's called Electrum. It's written in Python, used by many, many, many people. Also, if not everyone will probably want to develop their own blockchain or take part in blockchain development around blockchains in the ecosystems, we have many tools. As I mentioned, especially for Ethereum, this support is strong. There's a library called Web3Py, which enables one to interact with the Ethereum blockchain, which interact with smart contracts by writing Python, which is quite nice, since the actual language that Ethereum uses called Solidity for blockchains is somewhat complicated and easy to make errors in. Want to mention the awesome requests module, which per se doesn't have much to do with blockchains, but most blockchain nodes communicate to the outside with HTTP API with a JSON RPC, where requests is very nice to handle, to talk with those kinds of APIs. And many websites, many providers in the blockchain space have API clients for their APIs provided in Python, which are mostly open source. BlockCypher, Insight, those are some of the major players which have Python clients. And I'm even taking part. If you find any bugs in those clients, I'm happy to fix them. Using Python for the crypto stuff. So most blockchains are based on cryptography, public-private key infrastructure, and so on. Python has quite somewhat strong implementation itself. There is the awesome BTCPy library, which supports all kinds of Bitcoin transactions. There is a fork done by me and a few colleagues of mine to also support other coins, not just Bitcoin, which you can use this library to assign your own transaction to create a bit more complex transactions which give money to more people than just one. There's a more low-level implementation even called PyCoin, also written in Python, also a very low-level cryptographic has its own implementation of SHA and so on. There is a community of people developing crypto around Python. There is one elliptic curve that only has implementations in C and Python, which I found quite nice to be able to not have to go back to C and see that I can use a Python library. And then learning blockchain with Python. There are code snippets out on the web where people have written their own blockchain in Python in like 50 lines of codes. Those are not very awesome, but they're very nice ways to start learning about blockchains. We all know, well, rapid prototyping is nice in Python. There's many resources, there's many tutorials which deal with learning blockchain, which have examples in Python. So, so much for my talk. Are there questions?
Mostly no. So, thank you very much for this talk. We have, I think, some questions. So, I have a question. Well, so in your current work, do you work with blockchain, or you just as a fan and you work on it separately?
Yes, I do work with blockchain. We currently, what we do is we provide a secure way of getting data from production machines. For example, we have a customer who has a big machine that washes bottles. And the owner of the bottles, he transports the dirty bottles there, gets the clean bottles back, wants to be able to track how many bottles are actually broken through this process, and unfortunately cannot trust the owner of this machine, because he has an incentive to claim more broken bottles, since the insurance covers him very well for that. We put that data on the blockchain, and he can measure it directly on the machine, and he can has access to this blockchain. All parties, actually, there's four parties involved: the insurance, the bank that finances the machine owner, and machine user, which are four entities. And blockchain is a very awesome model when you have this many entities who all need access to the same data, and you need to guarantee each of those. Even if they don't trust us as a provider of the data is safe on there and cannot be modified and can be trusted.
So this is a very particular implementation, which is a really good use case for blockchain, I believe. So thank you very much. And